Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, or commonly known as Mahatma Gandhi, was one of the popular political personality of 20th century, and his legacy still continues. He is also christened as the father of the nation in India. He is regarded as the most prominent freedom fighter of India against the British colonial empire. On the other hand, there are very less references of other freedom fighters in history books. Even if there are mentions, they can be regarded as cursory at best. We may wonder what is so special about Gandhi to get him such extensive coverage, or were the prominent historians had a little amnesia? I have gone through 6 aspects of Mr. Gandhi's life in this video, and tried to bring out the real Mahatma, a history that has been carefully omitted in textbooks and other popular media to serve few vested interests. At the end, I will leave it to the judgment of the viewer to decide if they want to join the change.org campaign mentioned in the description section of this video.
South Africa, 1893. 50th year under the British crown. Gandhi embarked. Contrary to the popular belief, Gandhi had absolute disdain for native Africans.
General belief seems to prevail in the colony that the Indians are little better, if at all, than savages or the natives of Africa. Indian is being dragged down to the position of a raw Kaffir. The Boer government insulted the Indians by classing them with the Kaffirs.
This is not just one-off comment. He repeated racial slurs like Kaffirs and savages against Africans throughout his tenure in South Africa. Gandhi believed Indians and Europeans had the same Aryan descent, hence were superior to the black Africans. He said,
"I venture to point out that both the English and the Indians spring from a common stock called the Indo-Aryan."
Here are some more examples among many, and I fail to understand how few Indian historians conveniently try to whitewash Gandhi by saying he was dismissive of Africans only till his mid-30s. I guess this is called historians' amnesia that no medicine can cure. We should also remember that saying a few good words does not absolve a person from all the bad words he uttered unless he renders unconditional apology. Otherwise, it only demonstrates opportunistic behavior and hypocritical nature of the person. During Boer and Zulu wars against British Empire, Gandhi helped the British, built a group of stretcher bearers from Indians in South Africa to support the fallen British soldiers in the battlefield.
"We are in Natal by value of British power. It is our duty to render help. We should raise an ambulance corps."
The Zulu War killed 3,500 Zulus and made 30,000 of them homeless. That was the brutality of the colonial power, and Gandhi aided them. His loyalty to the Queen cannot be missed as well. At the height of the Zulu War in 1906, Empire Day was celebrated and Gandhi delivered an all-praising speech in the memory of Queen Victoria, who died in 1901.
"The memory of the noble lady remains as fresh as ever. She received wholehearted affection of India's millions. The great British Empire has not risen to its present proud position by methods of oppression. If there were more of Queen Victoria's spirit of enlightenment put into the affairs of the empire, we should be worthier followers of so great empire builder."
He did not even stop there. He requested military training for the Indians in South Africa to support British troops in war against the native Africans.
"We have more than once pointed out the criminal folly of not utilizing the admirable material the Indian community offers for additional defensive purposes. If it is not possible to turn the present Indian population out of the colony, it is surely elementary wisdom to give it an adequate military training. If the government only realized what reserve force is being wasted, they would make use of it and give Indians the opportunity of a thorough training for actual warfare."
Fantastic. Apostle of non-violence was offering Indians in South Africa to fight against the native Africans alongside the colonizer British Empire. He also advised Indian traders and others to donate to the fund drive for British soldiers. Before closing the chapter, I would like to mention that right after returning to India in 1915, Mr. Mahatma actively started recruiting Indians to fight for the empire in World War I. As per estimate, more than 74,000 Indian soldiers died in World War I fighting for the British cause.
"I recognize that, in the hour of its danger, we must give, as we have decided to give, ungrudging and unequivocal support to the empire, of which we aspire, in the near future, to be partners in the same sense as the dominions overseas. If I could make my countrymen retrace their steps, I would make them withdraw all the Congress resolutions, and not whisper, 'Home Rule,' or 'Responsible Government,' during the pendency of the war." I would make India offer all her able-bodied sons as a sacrifice to the empire at its critical moment, and I know that India by this very act would become the most favored partner in the empire and racial distinctions would become a thing of the past.
Lastly, we all should know that Gandhi's statue has been removed in 2018 from Ghana's prestigious university after protests against his racist activities and views in regards to the black Africans. This statue was inaugurated by the late Indian President Mr. Pranab Mukherjee in 2016. Students and citizens of Ghana started hashtag Gandhi must come down movement in change.org to ensure that the Gandhi statue is removed. Is it not a national shame for us that we still worship this racist person? When are we going to unlearn and relearn?
When we think of Mr. Gandhi, two things come to our mind first. His role in non-violence movements and his struggle against caste and untouchability. Isn't that so? Unfortunately, we accepted whatever has been taught or rather fed to us without asking further questions. Luckily, in the current age of freedom of information, age-old theories are being shattered. I will talk about ineffectiveness of his freedom movements in coming chapter. Here we will see Mr. Gandhi's real contribution as a social reformer. Mr. Gandhi's view on caste system was orthodox to say the least, or better to say very damaging for the society.
The Hindu social structure has endured, I believe, on the foundation of the caste system. The caste system contains within it the seed of Swaraj. The caste system is a perfectly natural institution. These being my views, I am opposed to the movements which are being carried on for the destruction of the system.
The law of heredity is an eternal law and any attempt to alter that law must lead us, as it has before led, to utter confusion. I can see very great use in considering a Brahmin to be always a Brahmin throughout his life. If he does not behave himself like a Brahmin, he will naturally cease to command the respect that is due to the real Brahmin. It is easy to imagine the innumerable difficulties if one were to set up a court of punishments and rewards, degradation and promotion. If Hindus believe, as they must believe, in reincarnation, transmigration, they must know that nature will, without any possibility of mistake, adjust the balance by degrading a Brahmin, if he misbehaves himself, by reincarnating him in a lower division, and translating one who lives the life of a Brahmin in his present incarnation to Brahmanhood in his next.
Gandhi wanted a man to go unpunished in the current life and leave the justice to the God to punish his reincarnation by demoting him to a lower caste. So does he mean Shudras and Dalits are getting punishment of their past life? I cannot believe this man was christened as Mahatma. Such garbage is unacceptable not only in a sensible society of today. Many social reformers fought against the curse of caste system even in that age. He continued.
It is as wrong to destroy caste because of the outcast, as it would be to destroy a body because of an ugly growth in it, or of a crop because of the weeds. It is merely an agency for ensuring self-control. We do not associate with members of other communities for eating or enter into marriage relationships with them. With an arrangement of this kind, there is a good chance that loose conduct will be kept down.
Now just understand the kind of propaganda it needed from a section of political classes and historians to make Mr. Gandhi as a friend of untouchables, a man who was absolutely against abolition of the caste system. How can you destroy vicious tree of untouchability if its root of caste system is kept intact?
This is just tip of the iceberg, viewers. Mr. Gandhi was a staunch supporter of the Varnashram system and he believed it is duty of the man to follow his ancestral profession. Otherwise, it would cause disruption in the society.
Varna means predetermination of the choice of man's profession. The law of Varna is that a man shall follow the profession of his ancestors for earning his livelihood. Varna therefore is in a way the law of heredity. Varnashrama, as I interpret it, satisfies the religious, social and economic needs of a community. Therefore, when people in disregard of the law mistake duties for privileges and try to pick and choose occupations for self-advancement, it leads to confusion of Varna and ultimate disruption of society.
Viewer, I do not know if this is not utter hypocrisy then what it is. Gandhi was happy as long as untouchables were accepted in the society and lent support to Congress. He was not interested in real upliftment of them. Curse of hereditary caste system will not go away until whole structure is abolished and Mr. Gandhi was all for its continuity.
One born a scavenger must earn his livelihood by being a scavenger, and then do whatever else he likes. For a scavenger is as worthy of his hire as a lawyer or your president. That, according to me, is Hinduism.
Seriously? Which Hinduism was he talking about? I have nothing else to say after this. Why would anyone acquire a new skill if he cannot earn a living out of it? Dr. Ambedkar rightly pointed out his hypocrisy.
Does the Mahatma practice what he preaches? It may be that his failure to practice is due to the innate hypocrisy of the man. The Mahatma is a Baniya by birth. His ancestors had abandoned trading in favor of ministership, which is a calling of the Brahmins. In his own life, before he became a Mahatma, when occasion came for him to choose his career, he preferred law to scales. On abandoning law, he became half saint and half politician. He has never touched trading, which is his ancestral calling.
Let's close this chapter with voice from Dr. Ambedkar.
We must be given equal opportunities, you see, so that we may rise to the level of the other classes. Mere washing off of untouchability is of no consequence. That they should have the same status, you see, in the country, and that they should have the opportunity to hold high offices, so that not only their dignity will rise, but also they will get what I call strategic positions, from which they could protect their own people. Mr. Gandhi was totally opposed. You see?
He was content with things like temple entry.
Temple entry, that was all the thing that he wanted to do. He was absolutely an orthodox Hindu. You see? He was never a reformer. You see? And he has no dynamics in him. You see? All this talk about untouchability was just for the purpose of making the untouchables drawn into the Congress.
There is no occasion for women to consider themselves subordinate or inferior to men. Woman is the companion of man, gifted with equal mental capacity.
Indeed, this was a very positive statement on women from Mr. Gandhi. He must have been very progressive, right? Wait, listen to the next statement from same Mr. Gandhi.
Home life is entirely the sphere of woman, and therefore in domestic affairs, in the upbringing and education of children, women ought to have more knowledge. I do not believe in women working for a living or undertaking commercial enterprises. To introduce English education in schools meant for women could only lead to prolonging our helplessness.
Yes, this was Mr. Gandhi's opinion about women's education. He wanted women to take care of home while men earned living. He wanted the education system to be tailored accordingly. Now, let's hear his view on women's sexuality. He wanted women to resist any sexual activity for pleasure and was absolutely against any birth control mechanism.
Contraceptives are an insult to womanhood. The difference between a prostitute and a woman using contraceptives is only this, that the former sells her body to several men, the latter sells it to one man. Man has no right to touch his wife so long as she does not wish to have a child, and the woman should have the willpower to resist even her own husband.
This is not the end to it. In one instance, instead of disciplining the boys, he gave the young girls a haircut to make them less attractive in order to save them from the prying eyes of those boys.
What mark should the girls bear so as to give them a sense of security and at the same time to sterilize the sinner's eye? I gently suggested to the girls that they might let me cut off their fine long hair. On the farm, we shaved and cut the hair off one another. I hope the young men still remember this incident and keep their eyes from sin.
In another instance, Mr. Gandhi indirectly blamed women for rape.
I have always held that it is physically impossible to violate a woman against her will. The outrage takes place only when she gives way to fear or does not realize her moral strength. If she cannot meet the assailant's physical might, her purity will give her the strength to die before he succeeds in violating her. It is my firm conviction that a fearless woman, who knows that her purity is her best shield, can never be dishonored. However beastly the man, he will bow in shame before the flame of her dazzling purity.
If this is the view of a man about women in general, we must be curious how he treated his wife, whom he referred as, "She was never the temptress." When Kasturba Gandhi was suffering with pneumonia, Gandhi did not allow doctors to administer penicillin, branding it as alien substance, and finally she died from this illness in 1944. Interestingly though, a few years later Mr. Gandhi used quinine to treat his malaria. Just to demonstrate what was his wife's value to him, this quote should be enough. Now please don't tell me he equated her with cow because cow was sacred to him.
I simply cannot bear to look at Ba's face. The expression is often like that on the face of a meek cow and gives one the feeling, as a cow occasionally does, that in her own dumb manner she is saying something.
Before closing this chapter, I would like to remind viewer of Mr. Gandhi's infamous experiment of celibacy with his grandnieces Manu and Abba by sleeping naked with them.
I have my grandniece with me. She shares the same bed with me. A duty cannot be shirked. We both may be killed by the Muslims and must put our purity to the ultimate test, so that we know that we are offering the purest of sacrifices, and we should now start sleeping naked. If I don't let Manu sleep with me, though I regard it as essential that she should, wouldn't that be a sign of weakness in me?
Apart from his grandniece Manu and Arba, Mr. Great Soul had multiple ladies as his sleeping and sexual experiment partner. Sushila Nair, the sister of Gandhi's secretary, used to sleep and bathe with him. Gandhi told,
"While she is bathing, I keep my eyes tightly shut. I do not know whether she bathes naked or with her underwear on. I can tell from the sound that she uses soap. What can be terrible is that she massages me while I am lying naked. So long as I have not become wholly free from passion, I have to be very alert while I bear with that massage."
This kind of strange obsession did not come late in his life. In his ashram in South Africa, even though men and women were housed separately, he encouraged the young ones to bathe and sleep together. In his own words, he wanted the young boys and girls not to fall for the temptation.
"I sent the boys reputed to be mischievous and the innocent young girls to bathe at the same time."
I do not know what modern-day psychologists would say about this kind of perversion. But beyond any doubt, such instances are definitely sexual abuses, misuse of power, and also punishable by law. Anyway, this was Mr. Gandhi on women empowerment. Now, where does the very first positive quote fit here? Nowhere. It only proves innate hypocrisy and duplicity of the man, or in Dr. Ambedkar's words, Gandhi was all the time double-dealing.
We have already discussed about Mr. Gandhi's insistence on military training of Indians to help British fight against native Zulu of South Africa. We also took notice of the fact how Mr. Gandhi recruited Indians in British Indian Army to fight for England in the First World War. But for some unknown reason, same Mr. Gandhi used to become very dismissive and disrespectful of armed revolution against British Empire and became ardent preacher of non-violence.
A white woman was killed by an explosion, intention was to kill a magistrate. We have no reason to rejoice at the introduction of Russian methods in India. The Indian people will not win their freedom through these methods. These incidents will distract people from their duty.
Mr. Gandhi said this when brave Khudiram Bose mistakenly killed a lady while trying to assassinate magistrate Douglas Kingsford's, who was well known for his notoriety against Indian revolutionaries. In another instance, after Udham Singh took the revenge of Jallianwala Bagh massacre by assassinating erstwhile Lieutenant Governor of Punjab, Michael O'Dwyer, this is what came out of Mr. Gandhi's pen.
"We had our differences with Michael O'Dwyer, but that should not prevent us from being grieved over his assassination. We have our grievances against Lord Zetlin. We must fight his reactionary policies, but there should be no malice or vindictiveness in our resistance. The accused is intoxicated with thought of bravery."
Yes, viewers. This is all Mr. Gandhi could utter when whole India was getting flooded with sympathy for Udham Singh. Intoxicated bravery. When Madan Lal Dhingra assassinated Curzon Willie in 1909, Gandhi called him mentally deranged and a coward.
"Mr. Dhingra's statement, according to me, argues mere childishness or mental derangement. In my view, he has acted like a coward. No act of treachery can ever profit a nation."
It is not surprising when it was time to fight for Bhagat Singh's clemency, Mr. Gandhi's effort was very much questionable. His sincerity can be very well understood from this letter to Viceroy.
"He is undoubtedly a brave man, but I would certainly say that he is not in his right mind. However, this is the evil of capital punishment, that it gives no opportunity to such a man to reform himself. I am putting this matter before you as a humanitarian issue and desire suspension of sentence in order that there may not be unnecessary turmoil in the country. I myself would release him, but I cannot expect any government to do so. I would not take it ill even if you do not give any reply on this issue."
Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose wrote in his book, The Indian Struggle, after Bhagat Singh's death, Gandhi faced hostile demonstration.
"Nevertheless, when the Mahatma alighted near Karachi, there was a hostile demonstration and several young men received him with black flowers and black garlands. The feeling among a considerable section of the youths was that the Mahatma had betrayed the cause of Bhagat Singh and his comrades."
Similar incident can be noticed during the Gandhi-Irwin Pact in March 1931. At that time also only the political prisoners of non-violent protests were released. Everybody else were left at the lurch of British torture in the prison. We all know how much Mr. Gandhi and his lieutenants opposed Netaji's view of armed movement against British Empire during the onset of Second World War, and Netaji was forced to resign even after winning the election as Congress president. During the Royal Navy Revolt of 1946, when revolutionaries in Navy were looking for political support and leadership, Mr. Gandhi once again distanced himself from them.
This mutiny in the Navy and what is following is not, in any sense of the term, nonviolent action. Burning of tramcars and other property, insulting and injuring Europeans is not nonviolence of the Congress type, much less mine. As it is, they are setting a bad and unbecoming example for India.
I will close this chapter with a letter from Sachindra Nath Sanyal, who was a founder of Hindustan Republican Association and is considered as mentor of Bhagat Singh.
You have criticized the revolutionaries most unsympathetically, and even you went so far as to describe them as the enemies of the country, simply because they differ from your views and methods. You preach tolerance, but you have been violently intolerant in your criticisms of the revolutionaries. The revolutionaries have risked their everything to serve their motherland, and if you cannot help them, at least be not intolerant towards them.
This appeasement politics did not start after independence. It started long ago, and Mr. Gandhi had his fair bit of role to play as well. There are multiple instances that can be cited when Gandhi chose appeasement for political gain during communal riots that ultimately caused more harm, especially to the majority Hindu community. This spans across multiple time periods, from Khilafat movement, Mopla riot in Malabar, Kohat riot in Rawalpindi during 1920s till Noakhali riot, Great Calcutta killing in 1940s, and even post-independence Kashmir war of 1948. Here we will focus on Khilafat and related Mopla riot only, as it had far-reaching impact in future and it fanned the pan-Islamism in the subcontinent. Due to the sensitivity of the topic, I will mostly rely on Dr. Ambedkar's narration in this chapter.
The movement was started by the Mohammedans. It was taken up by Mr. Gandhi with a tenacity and faith which must have surprised many Mohammedans themselves. There were many people who doubted the ethical basis of the Khilafat movement and tried to dissuade Mr. Gandhi from taking any part in a movement the ethical basis of which was so questionable. But Mr. Gandhi had so completely persuaded himself of the justice of the Khilafat agitation that he refused to yield to their advice.
Here is Mr. Gandhi's justification.
"But I would be untrue to my faith if I refused to assist in a just cause any men or measures that did not entirely coincide with the principle of non-violence. I would be promoting violence if, finding the Muslims to be in the right, I did not assist them by means strictly non-violent against those who had treacherously plotted the destruction of the dignity of Islam. Even when both parties believe in violence, there is often such a thing as justice on one side or the other. A robbed man has justice on his side, even though he may be preparing to regain the lost property by force."
Fantastic. Gandhi could justify violence against Zulu, Boer, anti-British forces during World War I, and now even for Indian Muslims as cause to defend Islam in Ottoman Empire in faraway Turkey. Even this dangerous pan-Islamism was a just cause to him. Was India's freedom from British not enough as a just cause? Dr. Ambedkar continued and tore apart Gandhi's hypocritical appeasement.
"He has never called the Muslims to account even when they have been guilty of gross crimes against Hindus. It is a notorious fact that many prominent Hindus who had offended the religious susceptibilities of the Muslims either by their writings or by their part in the Shuddhi movement have been murdered by some fanatic Muslims. The leading Muslims, however, never condemned these criminals. On the contrary, they were hailed as religious martyrs and agitation was carried on for clemency being shown to them. What is not understandable is the attitude of Mr. Gandhi. Mr. Gandhi has been very punctilious in the matter of condemning any and every act of violence and has forced the Congress, much against its will, to condemn it. But Mr. Gandhi has never protested against such murders. Not only have the Muslims not condemned these outrages, but even Mr. Gandhi has never called upon the leading Muslims to condemn them. He has kept silent over them."
Did this really help in Hindu-Muslim unity? How did this appeasement work out? It resulted Mopla riot in Malabar and Hindu genocide in the year of 1921 that killed thousands of Hindus. Let's hear from Dr. Ambedkar again.
"The aim was to establish the Kingdom of Islam by overthrowing the British government. Knives, swords and spears were secretly manufactured, bands of desperados collected for an attack on British authority. As a rebellion against the British government, it was quite understandable. but what baffled most was the treatment accorded by the Moplas to the Hindus of Malabar. The Hindus were visited by a dire fate at the hands of the Moplas. Massacres, forcible conversions, desecration of temples, foul outrages upon women, such as ripping open pregnant women, pillage, arson and destruction. In short, all the accompaniments of brutal and unrestrained barbarism were perpetrated freely by the Moplas upon the Hindus until such time as troops could be hurried to the task of restoring order through a difficult and extensive tract of the country.
Gandhi's appeasement did not end there. He conveniently laid the blame on the Hindus.
Hindus must find out the causes of Mopla fanaticism. They will find that they are not without blame. They have hitherto not cared for the Mopla. They have either treated him as a serf or dreaded him. They have not treated him as a friend and neighbor, to be reformed and respected. It is no use now becoming angry with the Moplas or the Muslims in general. My own experience but confirms the opinion that the Musalman as a rule is a bully and the Hindu as a rule is a coward. Need the Hindu blame the Musalman for his cowardice? Where there are cowards, there will always be bullies. But as a Hindu, I am more ashamed of Hindu cowardice than I am angry at the Musalman bullying.
Such an exemplary post-facto analysis. Let's celebrate his Jayanti on the 2nd of October with even more fervor. Before closing the chapter, I would like to reiterate that the entire episode of Khilafat movement resulted rise of Ali Brothers and Muslim League that finally ended up with partition of India. This should be a lesson to all even today. Viewers, we have come to the last chapter of this short video. Here my objective is to tell you about Mr. Gandhi's nonviolent movements in India and the efficacy of such activities in regards to India's freedom. I kept this chapter at the very end, because I wanted to ask you a very simple question. Would you be willing to accept a person whose ideas that are racist, casteist, politically opportunist, sexist, misogynist, sexually abusive and supportive of the British Crown, as your leader to lead India's freedom struggle? I do not think such person is capable of running any high public office, leave aside being the most prominent leader of the freedom movement. Before getting into further details on these movements, we should also know about Mr. Gandhi's vision of future India to understand this man's depth of thought.
I have no objection to your remaining in my country, but although you are the rulers, you will have to remain as servants of the people. You must not do anything that is contrary to our religions. It is your duty as rulers that for the sake of the Hindus you should eschew beef, and for the sake of Mohammedans you should avoid bacon and hum. We consider your schools and law courts to be useless. We want our own ancient schools and courts to be restored. The common language of India is not English but Hindi. You should therefore learn it. We cannot tolerate the idea of your spending money on railways and the military. Medical science is the concentrated essence of black magic. Quackery is infinitely preferable to what passes for high medical skill. Hospitals are the instruments that the devil has been using for his own purpose, in order to keep his hold on his kingdom. They perpetuate vice, misery and degradation, and real slavery. India's salvation consists in unlearning what she has learned during the past 50 years. The railways, telegraphs, hospitals, lawyers, doctors, and such like have all to go. Indians should wear no machine-made clothing, whether it comes out of European mills or Indian mills. England can help India to do this, and then she will have justified her hold of India.
Yes, viewers. This is what our father of the nation brought to the negotiation table with the British. Should I be happy that the British did not pay heed to his negotiation terms? Otherwise, we might have been living in a completely different India today. Apart from this, we should also know about Mr. Gandhi's opportunistic definition of Swaraj as per his own convenience. He played with different terms such as Hind Swaraj, Dominion Status and Purna Swaraj when referring to independence. When he said Dominion Status, he categorically meant, this does involve the existence of the empire. These words were so open for interpretation and his demands were so flexible that even Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose wrote about Purna Swaraj in 1930.
He virtually gave up the use of the word independence and substituted in his place the more elastic expression, substance of independence, or another expression especially coined by him, namely, Purna Swaraj, which he could interpret in his own way.
So this was Mr. Gandhi's vision on the idea of freedom. With that mind-blowing introduction, let's focus on his so-called freedom movements. It can be categorized into six phases. 1. Champaran agitation in 1917, 2. Kheda agitation in 1918, 3. Khilafat movement from 1919 to 1924, 4 Non-Cooperation Movement from 1920 to 1922, 5 Salt March or Dandi March in 1930, 6 Quit India Movement in 1942. We have already discussed about the complete lack of usefulness of Khilafat movement in regards to India's freedom struggle and the danger it carried. Both Champaran and Kheda movements were localized farmer agitation. Even though a section of the historians try to glorify these events, but the fact is by no means these two can be categorized as freedom movements. So here we will talk about rest of the three movements. We all have read about Gandhi's call to boycott British products, resign from public office, surrender of British-provided titles, withdraw students from government schools and colleges, boycott British courts, and refuse to pay taxes as part of non-cooperation movement. But I do not know how many of you know that as part of this movement in September 1920, Gandhi promised to give India Swaraj within 1 year, that is by September 1921, and started a fund drive called Tilak Swaraj Fund with a target of minimum 1 crore rupee in order to fund the non-cooperation movement.
If there is a sufficient response to my scheme, I make bold to reiterate my statement that you can gain Swaraja in the course of a year.
Anybody at that time would understand this promise did not have any basis. Even Subhash Chandra Bose had doubt in it. Netaji stated,
either he did not want to give out all his secrets prematurely or he did not have a clear conception of the tactics whereby the hands of the government could be forced. What was to him a question of faith, namely, that Swaraj would be won within 1 year, was by no means clear to me, and personally speaking, I was prepared to work for a much longer period.
But Gandhi continued his fund drive for Congress with full momentum to attain Swaraj in 1 year. He made several requests in public meetings and print media for donations with the promise of Swaraj. He repeated this request at least 20 times in a span of just few months. But as expected, Swaraj did not come by September 1921. In the meantime, people all over India suffered from police repression during the non-cooperation movement. He extended his promised timeline till December 1921 and tried emotional blackmailing through his newspaper. When the extended period also ended, Gandhi resorted to a strange view of Swaraj and declared, India is already free. I call it strange because how could he lie? After all, he was the Mahatma.
I share Pearson's view that India is already free. She became free when Lalaji, Pandit Nehru, Chittaranjan Das and Maulana Abul Kalam Azad were arrested. She became free as soon as it became clear that repression had fallen flat and that the people were not to be deterred from forming associations and holding public meetings even though they were assaulted and flogged.
Bravo Mahatma, bravo. I am speechless. By this definition of Swaraj, India became free in 1857 when Mangal Pandey died and inspired many, or when thousands of brave revolutionaries were shot or hanged and inspired the numerous Indians to come forward. This kind of juggling with words would even make today's politicians ashamed. Finally, on the 4th of February 1922, the Chauri Chura incident happened when demonstrators attacked and set fire to a police station. 22 policemen and 3 civilians died. Gandhi withdrew the non-cooperation movement. Many leaders in Congress did not support Gandhi's view of stopping the movement for such isolated incidents. Yes, he was just looking for an exit route from this movement and his promise of Swaraj. During the 1920s, when revolutionaries like Surya Sen, Sachindranath Sanyal, Bhagat Singh, Chandrasekhar Azad, Binoy Basu and hundreds of others were regaining strength after the setback of the Gadar movement during World War I that almost brought India to the brink of well-fought freedom, Mr. Gandhi realized high tax on salt would be the most critical item on the negotiation table. So he started his 24-day march on the 12th of March 1930 with his 78 trusted volunteers and travelled 390 kilometres from Sabarmati Ashram to Dandi. He broke the salt law on the 6th of April 1930 by collecting salt from seawater. After this incident, civil disobedience erupted in various parts of the country. Gandhi was sent to jail on the 5th of May 1930. Mr. Gandhi was released from jail on the 26th of January 1931. Finally, Mr. Gandhi came to an agreement with the Viceroy Mr. Irwin on the 5th of March 1931, which is known as the Gandhi-Irwin Pact in history. This ended the civil disobedience movement that started with the Salt March. After this less than a year movement, Gandhi had to let go of many of the demands, and the pact did not mention anything about independence or dominion status. In the words of J.B. Kripalani, a Gandhian himself,
"This pact was a compromise wherein Gandhiji had seemingly to give in a lot. Everybody expected that any pact with the government would include a judicial inquiry into the excesses committed by the police and the army during the course of the movement. Gandhiji was, however, requested by Irwin not to insist on such an inquiry, as it would affect his prestige. Gandhiji, always anxious to accommodate his opponents, agreed. Jawaharlal's reaction was different. He took it as a surrender and opposed it."
Subhash Chandra Bose also stated,
"The politically trained section of the people could analyze the terms of the pact, and to them it was a great disappointment. Youth organizations in the country, taken as a whole, were also dissatisfied. But to the mass of the people, it appeared as a great victory for the Congress."
Pact did not mention anything about independence other than trivial issues like permit to peaceful picketing, manufacturing salt from sea free of tax, etc. Netaji criticized the pact as it avoided the main issue of Swaraj, excluded the release of all other political prisoners except the non-violent protesters. And these were just two reasons among a total of 8 objections that Netaji had. Netaji even said the pact proved to be not a blessing but a curse. Before I move on to the next and the last phase of Gandhi's movements, that is Quit India movement of 1942, I would like to provide little details during the period between 1931 and 1942. During this period, Mr. Gandhi continued with his brilliant negotiation strategies with the British Empire. Gandhi went to London in September 1931 to attend the second round table conference and returned back to India empty-handed on the 28th of December 1931, though his image to the ordinary mass did not fade. Netaji wrote,
"Thanks to the propaganda of the Congress, the failure of the Mahatma to achieve something tangible for his country at the London conference had not produced any depressing effect."
In 1932, Congress launched another civil disobedience movement, urged people to boycott foreign clothes and goods like the last time. In the meantime, government also broke the Gandhi-Irwin Pact in several instances. But the government was prepared this time and suppressed the movement quickly, and Mr. Gandhi also officially suspended the movement on the 23rd of July 1933. In 1934, Mr. Gandhi resigned from Congress and devoted his entire energies to Harijan work. He started his India tour with goal of a big collection drive for Harijan Fund. He fasted for the cause of Harijan movement. This shifted the focus from the independence movement. Netaji wrote,
"There is no doubt that the fast served to sidetrack the civil disobedience movement and cause a diversion of men, money and public enthusiasm to the anti-touchability or Harijan."
Even though Mr. Gandhi was not there in active politics, he had huge popularity to the mass and clout over Indian National Congress. But younger leadership started showing dissatisfaction. J.B. Kripalani wrote,
"The discontent of this younger section became more and more manifest in their open criticism of Gandhiji. Some of them went so far as to consider Gandhiji a reactionary and a friend of the capitalists and even of the imperialists. A highly critical pamphlet was issued by Jayaprakash against Gandhiji."
After much deliberation, finally, on the 8th of August 1942, Mr. Gandhi delivered his Quit India speech in Bombay and the movement was officially launched. Even this time also, Gandhi and Congress was soft to British, which inherently made the movement a half-hearted effort. The Quit India resolution that was passed by Congress on the 14th of July 1942 stated,
"In making the proposal for the withdrawal of the British rule from India, the Congress has no desire whatsoever to embarrass Great Britain or the Allied powers in their prosecution of the war, or in any way to encourage aggression on India. Nor does the Congress intend to jeopardize the defensive capacity of the Allied powers. The Congress is therefore agreeable to the stationing of the armed forces of the Allied in India, should they so desire, in order to ward off and resist and protect and keep China."
British police and administration were well prepared for it. Next day morning, on the 9th of August, Mr. Gandhi and other Congress leaders were arrested and the whole movement virtually became leaderless. But agitation broke out in many parts of India and many became violent, such as torching post offices, police stations and railway stations. British administration launched brutal attack on the agitators. British controlled the movement within a few months, and within a year India became peaceful again. J.B. Kripalani described it as,
The casualties from August 9 to November 30, 1942 were, according to the Secretary of State for India, 1,008 killed, and 3,275 seriously injured. The popular estimate was very much higher. The number of people imprisoned was over 100,000. The movement had taken a turn not contemplated by Gandhiji and the Congress leaders. People went mad and in several places destroyed public property like bridges, police stations, etc., and removed even rail tracks, cut off telegraph wires and vented their anger in various other acts of violence. The government, by the use of overwhelming force, were able to put down the movement, but the spirit released could not be quelled.
This ends our final chapter. When we try to go deeper beyond the popular narrative fed through different channels in post-independent India, we understand that none of the movements of Mr. Gandhi were really effective. None of these brought us any closer to independence. These movements mobilized the mass only to go after a mirage. His movements were full of symbolism like khadi, salt, and fasting without much substance. British Empire never had more than 20,000 officials posted in India, and they ruled 300 million Indians by using Indian police and armed forces to control us, as well as use them to fight European wars. Only way to get rid of British was to instill fear in them for their life that revolutionaries did, and bring nationalism to cause defection in the armed forces that Subhash Chandra Bose and 1946 naval mutineers did. Let's face it, viewers. If there was no World War II that broke the backbone of the British Empire, if there was no Azad Hind Fauj, if there was no revolt in the armed forces in 1946, British would have continued for a very long period of time in India, and maybe even today we were living in some sort of a dominion status. I do not know about you. But I would never consider this man as a freedom fighter. At best he was a freedom negotiator, and that too with a very poor scorecard. Before concluding this video, let me ask you a question. Do you know how much content are dedicated for Gandhi and Congress in NCERT history books? Multiple chapters over 40 pages, and if you consider till grade 12, it is well over 100 pages. Now, do you know the name of Jatindranath Mukherjee, or commonly known as Bagha Jatin? If you are not from West Bengal, very likely you have not even heard this name. You will be surprised that this man was very close to free India from British clutch in 1915 itself during World War I with active help from Germany. A Czech spy betrayed his plan. An American publicist wrote,
"Had E.V. Vosker not interfered in this history, today nobody would have heard about Mahatma Gandhi and the father of the Indian nation would have been Bagha Jatin."
Do you know how many lines are written on Bagha Jatin on the same NCERT history books? Zero. A big zero. Not even a mention of his name. Same fate goes for all other revolutionaries. Either there is absolutely no mention, or left as just a footnote. Don't you think we Indians have done tremendous disservice to these real freedom fighters who sacrificed their everything for their motherland? For us, the reason we are born in a free country is due to these selfless souls. Thousands of INA soldiers who died fighting British Army and thousands many who sparked nationalism in the British Indian Armed Forces. Don't they deserve due respect from us? Even British High Commissioner John Freeman stated that the Royal Navy mutiny supported by the Army and the Air Force is the critical factor for British leaving India.
The British were petrified of a repeat of the 1857 mutiny, since this time they feared they would be slaughtered to the last man.
And what did we do? We named the cities, towns, roads, schools, colleges and whatnot after the great Mahatma Gandhi, who left numerous documented evidences that are anything but Mahan or great. I am at loss to understand what kind of greatness of soul Mr. Gandhi demonstrated in 1915 to be awarded the title of Mahatma on that year, other than showing absolute disregard for native Africans and open support to British Empire. Then we have the title Father of the Nation. As an Indian citizen, I object to the title of Father of the Nation. This land was ruled by 100 to 200 kings at any given point of time, was known by Hind, India, Indostan, Hindustan for many centuries before Mr. Gandhi was even born. So when I think of such person with lack of character integrity in personal life, having such regressive attitude towards African native people and women in general, having parochial attitude towards caste system and dubious contribution to the cause of Indian freedom struggle, I refuse to call him the father of the nation. It is an insult to many other finest human beings this land has produced by calling one single person with this title, and that too who has such questionable past. I request Indian government not to use either Mahatma or Father of the Nation to any government text including history books, and publicly state that India does not have such title. If any private citizen is using such title, it is completely his or her personal choice. Indian central and state governments should stop naming places and institutes after Mr. Gandhi and stop erecting statues of him in future. I am also requesting Indian government to revise the school history books to give due importance to other freedom fighters. I also request our government to stop printing Mr. Gandhi's picture on Indian currency notes. Rather show some respect to many other great souls of this land, such as Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, Swami Vivekanand, and Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar. If you agree to this, please join the change.org campaign and also spread the awareness. Campaign link is provided in the description. Thank you for watching this video, and I encourage you to read the article as well.